areas of the curriculum. This webinar combines two of my passions in English language teaching. First of all, using authentic children's literature, and secondly, teaching English through content from other areas of the curriculum, such as science, music, maths, etc. As English is increasingly repositioned as a core subject in many primary curriculums in countries around the world, there's an accompanying trend to teach subjects from other areas of the curriculum in English too. What this means is that in terms of the traditional teaching of basic interpersonal communication skills, BICS, which is the traditional territory of English language teaching, we're also involved in developing children's CALP, their cognitive and academic language proficiency. And this is following the work of Cummins. He first developed this in 1979 and has written many, many books and articles on this since. So what are we actually talking about here? BICS is the language of everyday communication, of conversations, of informal interaction. Whereas CALP, cognitive and academic language proficiency, is the language that we need to understand, or children need to understand, other content areas of the curriculum. So let's just have a little look at some of the features of BICS and CALP and how they're different. The major feature of BICS, and again this is absolutely following Cummins, is that language is context embedded. So what this means is that we have visual clues, it's face to face, there are concrete objects of reference within the context that we're talking about. It is also cognitively undemanding. In other words, it's easy to understand, usually simple language structures are used, and to do with everyday language occurrences. Let's have a look then at the features of CALP by comparison. That this CALP is context reduced, in other words, takes place in a context where those normal non-verbal features are not available to us and the language is more abstract. It's more cognitively demanding in the sense that the content relates to abstract concepts and there's a tendency also to use more complex language structure. Now I think it's helpful for us also at this stage to have a look at Cummins quadrants. Cummins quadrants actually help us to see the difference between BICS and CALP and to situate the difficulty of different tasks. For example, if we look in the top left-hand box, cognitively undemanding and context embedded, we might think of an example of going into a shop to buy a pizza or a cup of coffee, something that we can see the person we're interacting with, we can see the object that we're buying, and that it is cognitively undemanding. If we look at the bottom left-hand part of the quadrant, context embedded and cognitively demanding, we might think of something like a hands-on science experiment at school, where although we have all the visual clues within the context, the children can see, touch, feel what they're doing, nevertheless, the actual concepts they're working with may be quite demanding. On the right-hand side of the quadrant, if we look at the top part, cognitively undemanding and context reduced, we might think, for example, of a phone call to a friend, a chat on the telephone, where we can't see our friend, and so it is context reduced, but nevertheless it is undemanding. We're chatting about things we've done, things we're going to arrange to do, and so on. And in the bottom right-hand corner of the quadrant, we have context reduced and cognitively demanding. And so a little example there might be a reading text which doesn't have any accompanying illustrations, for example, and where children are reading including about scientific concepts. So Cummins is a model, it's a theory, it's not actually how things are, and I think this is very important to stress. There have been a number of critiques of Cummins' work, and I think it's important to particularly point out three of these, perhaps. The first one is that the difference between conversational and academic language is not quite as simple as this seems to suggest. It doesn't take into account, for example, the social context in which interaction takes place, or the domain, what people are talking about, or the relationship between the interlocutors. Another thing that has been critiqued about Cummins' theory is that it is, if you like, test-wise. In other words, that it's an artifact which is a result of particular ways of testing children and therefore dividing them up in particular ways. And more seriously still, it's sometimes been accused of potentially being, of leading to deficit theory. In other words, in schools where there are high immigrant population, looking at how they're not achieving on their level of CALP rather than any deficiencies in the system itself. So it's very important here that what I am saying about this is actually how useful it is for us as teachers to situate the level of challenge in the kind of tasks and activities that we do, rather than it being true. It is a theory and a model, and if you do any reading on content and language integrated learning, CLIL, you will come across Cummins' concepts quite a lot. And I think, going back to our topic, we can immediately see where picture books fit in this quadrant. That picture books fit in on the left side of the quadrant, on the context embedded side. In picture books, we have visuals, we have characters, we have subject matter related to content areas from other areas of the curriculum within a context that children can relate to and which can help them develop the cognitive and academic language proficiency they need, the kinds of things like measuring, comparing, contrasting, sequencing, justifying, and all those kind of things. Before we go on, I think it's also, before we get into the picture book part of things, I think it's actually worth us having a look at Cummins' iceberg model as well. Cummins' iceberg model, in the sense that it does look like an iceberg with L1 and L2 above the water, as it were, and below the water we have the CUP, which is the common underlying proficiency. Now, the common underlying proficiency is the kind of skills and metalinguistic skills that children acquire as they are learning their first language and which can be used when they are learning their second language as well. So, in other words, the theory being that the stronger children's cognitive underlying proficiency is in their first language, the more this will benefit them when they come to learning their second language as well. So this, I think, is quite interesting and also can make us think actually about questioning the possible wisdom in some contexts about the drive to develop children's cognitive, academic, and language proficiency through English at a very strong age, when perhaps there is also a case for us building up children's cognitive, academic, and language proficiency in their own language first, and as they develop more basic interpersonal communicative skills in English, and later more cognitive and psychological maturity, they will be able to transfer that to the learning of the second language. And at this point, I think it is also perhaps worth mentioning my colleague, good colleague, John Clegg, who is an expert on CLIL, and he talks about 12 factors for introducing CLIL successfully. And two of them that I would just like to point out now is, first of all, that children should have a good level of literacy in their first language, and that we should only start CLIL when after several years of good L1 medium education. So a little bit of background there, theoretical background if you like, but I think it helps us to have this kind of context before we go on to do, which we're going to do now, to have a look at the picture books, the kinds of picture books that are available to us when we want to teach cross-curricular themes. And this, whether we are doing it in a CLIL context, if you like, or in our own language teaching classrooms. It seems to me that we have, very simply, three types of picture books which we can use to teach cross-curricular themes. The first one is factual non-fiction, the kind of books which focus on science topics, if you like, the weather, plants, for example, that very often may have photos or textbook kind of illustrations, and use a descriptive or scientific register to get the facts across. The second type of picture book is, I've called, fictionalized science, maths, environment, nature, whatever it is. And by fictionalized, what I mean is that it's science, for example, say science, embedded in a narrative context, whereby there is often, for example, anthropomorphism, so there may be talking clouds or talking butterflies, and it's within the context of the narrative that the science concepts are conveyed to the children. The third type, of course, obviously, is fiction, where there is little or even no direct relation to a cross-curricular theme. So if you like, we can see these books as a continuum from F to F, from fact through fictionalized through to fiction. Now, just to kind of illustrate these with three examples, which I literally took off my bookshelves to show you, but so you can see examples of the kind of thing I mean. This is to do with the plant cycle, where on the left here we have Simple Science, a book about growing plants, where there are textbook type of drawings and pictures, and it's in a kind of science register. The one in the middle, which is fictionalized, A Seed in Need, it's a story, a narrative of what the seed needs to grow, and we have little dialogues between the butterfly and the ladybird, and in the course of the narrative, the children learn about the plant cycle. And the last example, the one I've got there, is The Tiny Seed, Eric Carl, another one of Eric Carl's wonderful books. And this is a fictional story of the tiny seed and all the adventures that the seed has to be able to survive and find somewhere to grow and become a beautiful plant. So for us as teachers, I think it's very important for us to think about the criteria that we need to use to decide which kind of book is going to be best for us to use for our teaching in our own particular circumstances and contexts. And so we need to weigh up the pros and cons of each kind of book. Now, let's have a look at these now. I've put these up for you so that you've got them in a very clear format. So, looking at the kind of factual non-fiction books, the pros of this, remember we're thinking about this from a teaching of cross-curricular themes point of view. First of all, there is accurate information. We know that the information has been researched. It's a junior reference book. So what it says is reflecting the real content and the real world. It also contains subject-specific vocabulary. So if this is what we're wanting to teach the children, then that is a very definite pro, because that vocabulary is embedded within the book. There are very often realistic illustrations and photos, and sometimes these days very beautiful photos, actually some modern factual books have. And the books also use an appropriate register, appropriate for the science, for example, that we want to teach. It's in a descriptive scientific register, describing actually what happens as part of that content rather than narrative. Looking over here at the cons, which my crosses have somehow converted into little boxes here, but they are actually crosses, okay? The first one there, a lack of meaningful context that the children can relate to. These are content facts in isolation from the children's own experience and reality. The second con is that the content and vocabulary is often too difficult. If we're talking about young learners of English, we may want them to learn more frequent and more useful vocabulary first, rather than very specialized, subject-specific vocabulary. Quite often, illustrations are dull. They're done in a realistic artwork style rather than in an imaginative style like the Eric Carle book I just showed you. And finally, they're not necessarily a page turner. You're not dying to hear what happens next. So the pros and cons of those kind of books, let's have a look now at the next place along our continuum, the fictionalized science books. Now here, we engage the children through narrative. The science concepts are presented in a format that children are familiar with, they're used to, they love, they enjoy. Young children think in a narrative format to start off with, and so it seems very reasonable and to make a lot of sense to present new science concepts in that context as well. So the context is familiar, relevant, and meaningful. Through the fictional aspects, we can actually awaken children's interest and curiosity. The little book I showed you, The Seed in Need, the dialogue between the butterfly and the ladybird, asking questions about what's happening to the seed, awakens the children's interest and curiosity in a very natural way. And these kind of books can also help children to understand new concepts. On the con side, sometimes these books are rather limited in content. They may have inaccurate illustrations. They haven't been done as junior reference books, so they may not show the content quite as accurately as they should. There may also be misconceptions through fantasy and anthropomorphism. Actually, I've put that as a con. I don't, in a way, really believe it. I've never had a young child have a problem with a ladybird who talks in a story and actually believes that ladybirds in real life also talk. But it is a potential con. The other con is that very often these books use a narrative rather than a scientific register. So actually, if it's the science that we want to teach the children, this may be a disadvantage, because we'll have to introduce the scientific register in another way. And lastly, let's have a look at our last type of book, fiction. Okay, and here, of course, we are engaging children through the narrative, and We're actually also, of course, developing children's basic interpersonal communicative skills through the use of things like direct speech in the stories. They have beautiful, appealing illustrations very often. Very, very attractive, lovely illustrations which children are naturally drawn towards. They can provide a very motivating springboard into learning content. The story may actually have nothing to do with content or a very loose link, but at the same time, we as teachers can mediate between the story and children learning about the science. They also provide a context for inquiry that very often, for example, with the tiny seed story, the children have read the adventure about the tiny seed, and they then use that as a context for finding out more about the plant cycle and how plants grow. On the con side, fiction may misrepresent the real world. Although, having said that, again, thinking of the example of the hungry caterpillar, which I'm sure you all know, for example, I have never had a problem with a child who thinks that caterpillars really eat lollipops, for example. The link between fiction and content is tenuous. It can be tenuous. The hungry caterpillar, actually, it isn't very tenuous. That leads very directly to learning about the life cycle of the caterpillar, but it can be. We need to teach the content vocabulary and register. This, yes, is definitely the case. There still may be other reasons for choosing fiction, but actually if what we want to be teaching is the science, we're going to need to introduce that subject-specific vocabulary and also the scientific register. And in this case, it's possibly going to be more time-consuming, and if we have limited time, limited class time, limited time in our curriculums, which most of us do, then this may be a problem. Okay, so let's have a look now at how some of this might work in practice, or at least a sample of how it might work. And to start off with, I want to use an example of fiction, and this is the most wonderful book, Lost and Found. I wonder how many of you out there know it, by the author-illustrator Oliver Jeffers. It's the wonderful story of a boy, and one day a penguin turns up at his door, and the boy doesn't know where the penguin comes from and where he has to take him back to. The penguin is sad and lost, and the boy decides to take it home if only he knows where home is. So already there we have a lovely entree into our cross-curricular theme. Could I ask you now out there, if a penguin showed up on your doorstep, where would you take it back to? If you're on your own, well, you can type in the chat box, or if you're with other people, do talk about it. And I'm sure you said, yeah, the South Pole or Antarctica. And leading into this topic, let's have a look at these other animals. If you could just look at the animals on your screen for a moment and identify what they are. You could just do that if you're with anyone else. You could just do it together. Okay, so the first one there is a whale, and then we have a polar bear, and then a penguin, of course, which we know goes back to the South Pole or Antarctica. And we then have a seal, number 4, and a walrus, number 5, and a puffin, number 6. So if I were to ask you if a whale or if a polar bear turned up on your doorstep, where would you take them back to? The North Pole? The South Pole? Or doesn't it matter? They can go to both. Would you like to talk about it if you're with colleagues, or put your answers in the chat box? Okay. Because what we'll do with the children is actually ask them this, as part of our interweaving with the story, and they will then listen, do a listening activity to find the answers. We're not going to do that listening activity now, but I'll put you out of your agony, in case you are in any agony, to know where you would take these back to. So a whale you can take back to either the North Pole or the South Pole, it doesn't matter, both. The polar bear you need to take back to the Arctic, okay. The penguin we know about, the seal you can take to the Arctic or Antarctica, North Pole or South Pole, it doesn't matter, they live in both. The walrus, you need to take to the Arctic, that's it, brilliant. And the puffin to the Arctic as well. So in this little activity where the children have made their predictions, they've listened, they've found out the answers, we're already awakening their curiosity about the South and the North Pole, okay? So, we ask the children, what's similar and what's different about the North and South Poles? And the children can predict what they think are the differences. So they may come up with things like that it's dark for 6 months of the year, that there are glaciers and icebergs and so on. We can use this as an opportunity also to introduce vocabulary. And what we're going to go on to do with the children then is to actually read a text. Now, I'm showing you this text up here now. I'm not expecting you to read it all now. But you may like to come back, you know, once you can download this and have a look at it later. But actually, what the task here for the children to do, and what I like to do, I put the children in pairs, and I ask one child in each pair to find 7 similarities between the North and the South Pole in the text, and the other child in each pair to find 7 differences. Okay, so they read the text, they're working in collaboration together, but they actually have a different task to do. So we then find out what they think, and what we go on to do, and this is very important in terms of our theme this afternoon, is I actually get the children to classify that information using a graphic organizer, in this case, a Venn diagram. There's been a lot written about in the CLIL literature, the content-based language teaching literature, of the importance of using graphic organizers to develop basic cognitive processing skills. And so what we're doing here is taking the information from the text and getting the children to actually process it and internalize it by recording it in this Venn diagram. Now, let's not lose sight of our story, because we are linking and interweaving all of this with our story, Lost and Found. When we come back to the story again and we read it to the children, when we get to the point in the story where the boy has discovered that the penguin lives in the South Pole, we ask the children, so what's it like in the South Pole? So what we are doing is providing a natural context in the classroom where children are given an opportunity to reuse what they've learned about the South Pole in a communicative context of talking about the boy in the story who doesn't know what the South Pole is like. And what we're also going to do with this story, or what I do, what I like to do with this story, is some creative writing. Because in this story, which, as I've told you, is the most touching, wonderful story, the boy takes the penguin back to Antarctica and leaves the penguin there. When the boy leaves the penguin, he realizes that the penguin is looking absolutely miserable and sad as can be. And the boy rows off home, and after he's gone a short way, he realizes the penny drops, that actually the penguin doesn't want to be in the South Pole at all. He's lonely. So the boy goes back to pick the penguin up. And importantly, there is a beautiful illustration in this book where they miss each other going round an iceberg, but eventually find each other. And the story ends with this wonderful hug, and they go back home to the boy's home together, talking about wonderful things on the way. In terms of our developing children's creative writing skills, there are some wonderful opportunities here. And I put two of them up on the screen here. First of all, that the children write a dialogue about the wonderful things that the boy and the penguin talk about on the way home. And it starts off, this dialogue, for example, "Tell me, what's it like at the South Pole?" Well, with the integrated work on our cross-curricular theme that we have done, the children are super prepared in terms of their knowledge, in terms of their vocabulary, in terms of the descriptive scientific register, to be able to weave that in to this creative writing task. And another activity that we can do is parallel story writing, whereby we go back to the animals that we previously identified as living in the North Pole or the South Pole, Arctic or Antarctica, and the children write a parallel story. So they choose, for example, once there was a girl, once there was a boy, and one day he found a polar bear cub at his door, for example. And they use the story, not as a direct model, but more as an inspiration for their own story, which is also reinforced and enriched by what they've been learning in terms of the cross-curricular theme. At the point in the story, when we come back to the story again, I told you that there was the boy and the penguin lose each other around an iceberg. So again, this is a wonderful opportunity to actually go a little bit deeper into our cross-curricular theme and for children to learn about icebergs. So as an example of what we might do, we might have children reading a text about icebergs and doing an iceberg quiz based on what they learn about icebergs, and leading on to, and this is something that is very important in terms of personalizing learning of real content and making children feel ownership of it, that the children are going to make a little fact file of the North and South Poles, which they complete, which they use as a springboard to finding out further things. They can questions that they want to find out the answers to, that they can then go on to specific websites to find those answers to, and so on. And also, importantly, includes a personalized element, so that the children are actually saying, "I would like to go to the North Pole or the South Pole because of the polar lights, or because it has the biggest icebergs, or whatever it is, whatever reason it is that they want to go." So there is an example then of how we can use a fiction book as a springboard for exploration into a cross-curricular theme. And the way we would do this, it would be to interweave are tellings of the story, with the children finding out about the cross-curricular area, so that each would build on and enrich the other. I'd like us to have a quick look at another example now, and this is one of my personal favorite storybooks, Lauren Child, and she has a whole series of picture books based on Charlie and Lola. Charlie is a boy and Lola is his very annoying sometimes little sister. And the books are absolutely beautiful. They're done with a mixture of photos and artwork. And they touch on themes that are very, very close to most children's hearts. This particular one touches on the theme of food, and most young children have food things that they really hate and don't want to eat at all, despite all the persuasion by their parents and carers and so on. And this story, as well as being wonderful for food vocabulary and learning about food, touches on this very real issue for many children. And something that we can, and there are obviously many, many things that we can do with this book, but one thing we can do with Lola, "I will not ever, never eat a tomato," is actually do a rap based on that. Okay, so this is Lola's food rap. Now, I know you're all out there and I can't hear you at all, but it would just be brilliant if you join in doing this with me. Lola's food rap goes, "I don't eat carrots, I don't eat peas, and I will not ever, no, never, no, never, never, never eat a tomato." Okay, so we get the lovely stress there. And for children, it is so enjoyable to say, "I will not ever, no, never." How often are children actually allowed and encouraged and able to do that? And so obviously what we go on to do is actually get children to create their own food wrap where they talk about the food that they don't want to eat. So this is a kind of creative, very language teaching kind of activity. And similarly, the role play that we can go on to do. In the story, Charlie manages to get Lola to eat her dinner by inventing what various foodstuffs are. Okay. And Lola just tries a little bit, and at the end of the story, she plays her own trick on Charlie. So one of the things I always ask the children at the end is actually, who's cleverer, Lola or Charlie? And this pattern of Lola saying what she doesn't eat and Charlie inventing and pretending that food is something else is a wonderful springboard into a role play, okay, where this what you have on the screen in front of you is a kind of support for this role play, which can be set up in any way that you like. But here, for example, from the story, Lola actually says in the story, "Oh no, I don't eat peas." And Charlie says, "But these are not peas. They are green drops from Greenland." And Lola says, "Well, I might just try one." So then we've got other food that isn't directly in the story. The second one there is an example for the children. "Oh no, I don't eat cauliflower." "But this is not cauliflower. It is white coral from the moon." So the first stage of the activity, the children invent what the food can possibly be. "Oh no, I don't eat spaghetti. But this is not spaghetti. This is mermaid's hair from the bottom of the sea," for example. Okay. So What we're then going to do is to set up a role play, which may be as simple or elaborate as you like, depending on the children and depending on their level. It could go something like, would you like peas, Lola? Oh no, I don't eat peas. But these are not peas, they are green drops from Greenland. Oh, okay. Well, I might just try one. Mmm, very delicious. Can I have another one, Charlie? And so on. So in other words, what we're doing here is building on the fictional side of the story, the creative side of the story, in a traditional language teaching context, if you like. But we're also going to use the story and use Lola's fussiness about different types of food as a springboard into learning about food, about nutrients in food, and for example, about the food pyramid, okay? The food pyramid and where different items of food actually go in the pyramid. And we might also do, and this is what I wanted to show you about how using fiction can help provide a context that children relate to, where here the children are reading about a description of different food groups, and they are then going to classify the food. But the important thing here, this is not just any old food in isolation. This is, we're doing it for Lola, because this is all the food in the story that Lola says she will not ever eat. So what we're doing is classifying the food in order to be able to find out what Lola should eat more of. Now, there's something that immediately engages the children in doing this in a way, it makes it much more meaningful than if you just give them a text and say, you know, read about this food, classify it. We're doing it to find out about Lola, and that's also one remove from ourselves, which also makes the children feel secure and comfortable. It's not as if you're in a heavy-handed way getting at them either about what they eat. So those are a couple of examples there. What I'd like us to have a look at now is a couple of examples of books which are fictionalized science. Okay. And the first one that I've got to show you here is Oscar and the Frog, a book about growing. And this is actually a book that's been developed in the UK for Key Stage 1 science, because of this importance of children learning science concepts through narrative. And it's actually a wonderful story, or a series of stories in a way, because it's about growing, about people growing, about plants growing, and also about frogs growing. And Oscar is a kitten who doesn't know very much about the world at all. And the frog is his kind of mentor and guide and tells him about things. So there's a lovely part in the book, for example, when the frog is telling Oscar his life history. So what's happening here is that we're learning science concepts within a familiar narrative discourse. At the same time, within the narrative discourse, the frog uses the subject-specific vocabulary. He talks about gills, for example, and lungs, and when he was a little egg, being like a dot in jelly. So he's using subject-specific vocabulary, but within a narrative context that that makes it very, very engaging for the children. On the same theme for younger children, this one would be sort of 6 to 8 year olds, for example, depending on the context, of course. But for younger children, another one on a similar theme is this one here called Is It a Frog? Which is a flap book for younger children. And again, in this story, there is a fish and a beetle. And there, the story is the way the fish and the beetle discover these eggs under a stone in the pond and gradually see their transformation into tadpoles and into a frog. And as a flat book, it's wonderful doing this book with children who are five and six, okay? They come and lift up the flaps to see what's underneath. And there's a lovely chorus line in it where fish or ant, every time there's a new revelation in the development from the egg to the frog, they go, wow, fantastic. And all the children quickly get this chorus and go, wow, fantastic. But of course, what we're doing here is we're teaching language, of course, but we are also teaching the science concepts. And here, for example, a little activity sheet that the children can do recording the life cycle of the frog. So this, in a way, is a very brief going through of the way, my preferred way of working with children, where we're actually integrating creative, imaginative, fictional work with learning about the real world, learning about content. And in terms of little content projects, content and language integrated learning projects, if you like. For example, here's a little one here, The World of Animals, where the children do a project classifying animals, finding out about habitats, camouflage, food and food chains, life cycles, and endangered animals. But actually, one of the richest ways of approaching a project like this is when you can integrate and interweave it with picture books. And the picture books may be, depending on your circumstances, who you're teaching, the context, how many hours a week they have, and so on, maybe fiction, fact, all fictionalized, but we are interweaving them. For example, a storybook that works wonderfully with this kind of project is Monkey Puzzle by Julia Donaldson. In fact, any animal book, even the one we did earlier, The Lost and Found, we could weave in with a project like this. Similarly, here's one on food that we could interweave with the Charlie and Lola story I talked about, or with any other picture books. There are plenty that deal with issues of food. Eat Your Peas, for example, is one that I can think of off the top of my head. So what I think we're talking about here is actually looking at teaching cross-curricular themes, depending on whether we're doing content and language integrated learning, and whether we are at a weak end of the continuum or at a strong end of the continuum, and how we are going to approach this. So bringing things to a conclusion before we have time for some questions, I hope, my summary and conclusions here, that content on its own may be dry and unappealing, that content doesn't necessarily engage children just for its own sake. We need to give it a context that children can relate to, that makes that connection between the concepts that they're learning and their own real life experience. The second point, narrative register helps children understand cross-curricular concepts. There's been quite a lot of research on this area, particularly in the States, and looking at how young children learn science concepts most easily, very often, when they are presented through a narrative kind of format. The next point, that fictionalizing allows for the development of both BICS, remember, the basic interpersonal communicative skills, and CALP, cognitive and academic language proficiency. As I see it, the one nourishes the other, and we're doing our children a favor in terms of successful and effective learning if we integrate both of those things. That children develop cognitive skills and language skills in a naturally integrated way. We're not falsely isolating both things. This is what happens in other areas of the curriculum in their own language, and what we want to try and achieve in English as well. Working in this kind of way with children enhances creativity, imagination, citizenship, as well as children's knowledge of the real world. And the last point there, that I think when we work this in this kind of way with authentic children's literature and integrating real content, we help to make learning more meaningful, motivating, and those three M's, which are easy to say and very often hard to do. Okay, so that's the end of the webinar. If you have any questions, over to you. To receive your certificate of attendance, I think Caroline already mentioned this. Thank you very much to everyone for being there, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Oh, you can't see me. Can they see us?
No, I think you just disappeared then. Well, applauding. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Great presentation. Any questions?
No questions. Can they?
I can't see you. They're still.
Okay. No questions. I'm happy to answer any questions.
I can't stop the recording. She's going to click on that pause button at the bottom.